Hi, my name is Kametrius, and I'm going to be talking about Gregor Mendel and the gene idea, which is a lecture we went over in class. I'm going to be talking about who was Gregor Mendel and the question he was interested in answering, and explain how Gregor Mendel used the pea plant to answer that question, and what are the two primary laws that were discovered by his experimentation. And also, I'm going to define the vocabulary, which is allele, dominant, recessive, characteristics, traits, homozygous, heterozygous. Now, and then I'm going to explain what Punnett square is. Everybody should know what Punnett square is. High school. Now, Gregor Mendel, he was the father of genetics. He was an Austrian monk born in 1822. He wondered how does genetic material get passed down to offspring. So he experiments with a pea plant to discover heredity. And he has two hypotheses here. The first one was blending traits are acquired through blending from both parents. Like, for example, pink and the red flower make pink flower, which could be possible depending on the genes of both flowers. Particulate hypothesis, there are discrete heritable units. There are, depending on genes. Now, I'm going to talk about both the Gregor Mendel with heredity, and I'm also going to bring in DNA and RNA. So, first step, we're going to talk about is cross-pollination, which is pollinating one plant with a different plant. So, let's say, for an example, if you have a purple plant here, it is a white plant. And then we'll go down here to the next area here. And this is F1 generation. And this saying that all plants had purple flowers. And this is F2 generation. So this one says, you had, for an example, 500 purple plants, 500 white plants. And that's in the F2 generation. So that shows about cross-pollination. Now I'm going to go on about the seven characters I'm going to be talking about, because the way he compared the traits, he did by the shape, the color of the seeds, color of the pods, shape of the pods, the plant height, position of flowers, and the flower color. Now, I'm going to do a codominance here. So, codominance is a form of dominance where the alleles of a gene pair, which are in a heterozygote, are fully expressed. So it's neither dominant or recessive. So we can start with this. You would have big H, little h up here for the mother, little h for the father. Okay, so big H, little h, little h, little h, big H, little h, and that looks like an N, little h, little h. So your genotypes, you would have two that were created by the mother and the father, which will be, your genotypes would be the big H, little h, you have two of those, and you have two little h's. Now your phenotype will be 50-50, which is also a ratio of 2-4. So, 50-50, your ratio will be 2-4. So, now, they're neither dominant or recessive. That These two are carriers. They can be carriers of that gene of being wrinkled. They can, if they're heterozygous this way, they are a carrier. But if they're homozygous dominant, they will not have that wrinkled trait. They will have the full round shape they will usually have if they're homozygous dominant. So heterozygous, you would have, so heterozygous, you would have like a capital and a lowercase. Homozygous, you would either have two capital letters or two lowercases. Like for an example, I would do for homozygous, we would say big H, big H, little H, little H. Heterozygous, like from the last example, which would be big H, little H. Okay? Now, the dominant gene is what you will always see. You will never see, you rarely would see the recessive gene on a person. Like for an example, let's say that you have a dominant parent with brown eyes. So, but she's homozygous dominant. And the father, he will be homozygous recessive. So he'll be recessively with little b. So he has, because the mother has brown eyes, the father can have hazel eyes. Let's just say that. So big B, little b, big B, little b, big B, little b, big B, little b. And what this is called is pure dominance. Okay? So now pure dominance, it just means that same exact alleles are present. Now, still, these are carriers for the hazel eyes. So they could have that. They could have that gene still. Unless you have two dominant parents that are homozygous dominant, which will be different. Now, I'm gonna keep the mother with the black eyes, I'm gonna keep her there. And we're gonna change it to brown eyes. And we're gonna have a mother with brown eyes and a father with brown eyes. You'll get all capital B's. And all of them are dominant, homozygous dominants. So they will all have brown eyes, unless the both parents were heterozygous. Now, if they were heterozygous, you would have this one have brown. This one would have brown. No, yeah, this will be brown. This will be. Okay. So you have big B, big B. But this time on this one, you will have carriers still here. But you will still have a 50-50 ratio, and it's a 2-4 ratio of those kids having that gene, that brown ass. Okay, so now I'm going to explain here about phosphodiester bonds, which is DNA and RNA. So the phosphodiester bond is the linkage between the 3 carbon atom of one sugar molecule and the 5 carbon atom of another. I have a image of a phosphodiester bond. For example, you will have a pentose right here. If I can draw it, I can't draw. And let's say, for example, you have on it, you have oxygen here, hydrogen. Oxygen. So now, and then you have this. I'm going to go ahead and draw it out. Okay. So now, it's that bond between the phosphate and the phosphate group and the sugar. So that's your sugar in this room. And that's the phosphate group. Phosphate group and your sugar. So it's that bond that's in between it, which is right here, which is the bond. And, okay. So now I'm going to go back to Gregor Mendel here, and we're going to talk about his two laws that were discovered by the pea plant experiments. You have the law of independent assortment, which means that, which is also like the principle of independent assortment, which is the second law. Genes for different traits assort independently from another in the formation of gametes. And we know gametes are like sex cells. So. And the law of segregation are the two members of a gene pair alleles, they segregate, they separate from each other in the formation of gametes. Half the gametes carry one allele while the other half carries the other allele. So basically the alleles separate and they go to different alleles. The gametes separate and then they go to different alleles. The two members of the gene pair, which are the alleles, they segregate. Sorry about that. Correction. And dominant allele, like I said earlier, you will be able to see the dominant allele. You will rarely see the recessive allele. Like if someone may have brown hair, but if they discover in the gene that they have a recessive blonde hair. So like the mother can be blonde, the father can be brown hair. So it would not matter if she was dominant for brown, like homozygous dominant for brown hair, blonde hair, and the father was homozygous dominant for brown hair. But now they can have either the blonde or the brown hair, but the blonde hair will be covered by the brown hair because the brown hair will be more dominant than the blonde hair is. The blonde hair will be more recessive since it's a lighter color. So like dominant alleles, the allele that is expressed when two different alleles or two dominant alleles are present. Dominant is always uppercase. Letter, like for example, uppercase A. Recessive is uppercase A. Now, when you do this, because for an example, let's say if I put like big A, little A, oops, little A, you'd be big A, little A, blah, blah, blah. You see, you can be a carrier of that recessive gene. You're dominant from this, but you carry this gene here. If the parent is homozygous dominant and the father is homozygous recessive, you can still, let's say this is just brown hair, the brown hair father, blonde hair mother. You can carry that blonde gene, the blonde hair gene. You just won't be able to see it because it's recessive. Now, if it was the other way around, like if she was dominant for blonde hair, but he was recessive for brown hair, then it would be, then you can see the blonde hair because the dominant gene will be blonde, but the recessive gene will be brown. So now, oops. Okay. So now, and I'm going to talk about allele pairs, which Big B, for example, this is homozygous. Also, little B, is also homozygous. This is homozygous dominant. This is homozygous recessive. This is heterozygous. If you have a capital B and a lowercase b, this is hetero. It does not matter if you switch those two around, it'll still be heterozygous. So now, the next thing, I'm going to talk about the principle of dominance. So the principle of dominance is states that some alleles are dominant, some are recessive. You can have an organism with at least one dominant allele for a trait. It'll exhibit that form of the trait. And then an organism with a recessive allele with that trait, it will exhibit that form only when the dominant allele for the trait is not present. That's like eye color. And I'm going to use Punnett square. Well, the Punnett square is what I used earlier, and that's what I was talking about earlier for the principle of dominance. And now I talked about I'm gonna go over the degrees of gene dominance. Like complete dominance, which is, like I say, the complete dominance, you will never see the recessive gene anywhere. The recessive allele is completely covered. You won't see it. You won't even notice it. Now, and like I said earlier, with codominance can be neither dominant nor recessive. Incomplete dominance is so incomplete is like, let's say like let's see, you can use like two flowers that are, you can use a red flower and a white flower. If those two flowers mix, you would have pink. Right? So you have red flower here and a white flower right here. And when you mix those, the red and the white mixes and it creates pink. And all of the flowers here in this Punnett square will be pink flowers if these two mix. And that's incomplete dominance. Okay. So next. Okay. I'm going to talk about. Okay, let's see. What I'm going to do now is I'm gonna jump to DNA here. So we have DNA. So DNA is basically a double helix. So then.